make robots that are as smart and as good at you at doing all the things you do. You don't do anything optimally. You do everything kind of sort of okay, not that great, but you can do like almost anything. So the question is, how can we get robots to do that? Like, how do we do general purpose intelligence? So we've seen awesome pieces and parts, ways of navigating, ways of manipulating. How do we put them together? All right, so I think of my job as, I do software, I don't do hardware, so awesome people make hardware, I work on software. I think of my job as the job of a robot factory. I have to think about how to build robots, what software to put in the head of a robot, so that when I send a robot to your house, it can figure out what to do, right? And so, obviously, there's something that's general purpose that maybe I can build it in the factory, and there's some very specific stuff that it's gonna have to maybe figure out at your house. So the question is, how do we think about, how do we design robots that are very general, just in a way that you came, arrived on this earth in a pretty general way, but still had to learn some stuff. Okay, so let me just think about ways of building general purpose AI. So historically, we've thought of different ways of doing it. One way is to reverse engineer humans, right? We could study the brain. If we figured out how brains worked, we could instantiate brains in robots and we'd be done. Another strategy would be to try to somehow replicate what evolution did, right? Evolution did pretty good. Here we are. So that was good. If we could replicate that, that would be another way to do AI. And that maybe more old school and traditional way has been to apply kind of classical engineering approaches to understand the problem, to design solutions, and to kind of approach things that way. I want to argue that in this moment, things are super exciting, but we kind of have something that's like a technical monoculture. So almost everyone who's trying to build robots right now is working on doing offline learning, right? So we do reinforcement learning or behavior cloning or kind of neural network supervised training offline in a simulator or in a car or on a safe track. And that's kind of like trying to replicate evolution, right? We do this offline learning, we get the artifact and we put it in the robot. And that's a really great thing, and it has made enormous strides. But I think that, in fact, there's something to be gained from all of these approaches, and that trying to understand something about natural systems, how they work, what the pieces and parts are, what design nature came up with, and also applying good engineering principles will help us actually arrive more quickly at systems that are more maybe reliable and safe and understandable than only doing offline learning. So let me talk to you now about a couple of technical pieces of work that we've done of this kind. So, okay, so the first thing is that if you're gonna have a robot doing learning, it better not be doing like too most of its learning in my house or your house, right? So, you know, the laws of physics should come in the robot's head when it shows up at your house. Maybe it has to learn where you keep the tea or how to turn the hot water tap on in your kitchen, but it should already like know a lot about what's going on. So it has to come out of the box, in a sense, like pretty ready to go, but also still plastic, still able to learn new things. So there's an interesting tension and balance here. And so we need to learn efficiently from very little data, and I think the fundamental idea, but not just me, right, this is a foundational idea in computer science and engineering, is compositionality, right? The way that you can learn generalize aggressively from a small amount of data and experience is by learning little pieces and parts and then putting them together in totally new ways to solve totally new problems. And that's what I think needs to be the foundation of really a generally intelligent robot. This is an old idea. Von Humboldt said, oh, this is like language in which we make infinite use. We can put infinitely many sentences together of finite means, the vocabulary that we have. The way I like to think about it is that it's, you know, using the computational, the combinatorial explosion in your own favor. Okay, so I'm just gonna now illustrate for you a couple of examples of work of this kind that we've been doing in our lab. So this is a recent piece of work by a student of mine, Jiayuan Mao, in which we tried to think about what you learn when you learn a trick, right? So the example, which we can't do yet with a robot, but an example is tiddlywinks, right? So in tiddlywinks, it's a funny game. You push a little piece of plastic down on top of another piece of plastic and you make it hop. Now, you might not invent the tiddlywink idea, right? That's kind of a hard idea, kind of a weird idea. But if you see it once, you totally get it. Right? And you totally get it because you already kind of know about physics and the basic ideas of leverage and stuff. I don't know, but you get it. So that's what we tried to do. We tried to say, well, all right, what does it mean? How can I learn from a single demonstration the basic idea, the basic trick, and then maybe mess around just a little bit to fine tune it? So I'm gonna show you now just a demo reel of some examples. In each case, we showed the robot one instance of this in simulation, and then it messed around and it learned how to do it more generally. So the robot can't pick this plate up off the table because its hand is too fat, but if you show it that it can scoot it to the edge of the table, it's like, oh, totally, I can do that. It can, like here, it can pick up the table, the plate in a different way by dropping an object on it and flipping it up. It learns the idea of using a tool to poke something out from between a crack and then pick it up. Here, we told it that it had to put the plate somehow not on the table. Here, we told it that the object needed to be on that ramp, but not on the table, and it figured out to put something in the way. So now, what's interesting is after it's learned these tricks, it can use them in combination to solve more complicated problems. Like it can use the hook to scoot the block near to where it is so that it can put it in the way and put the block on the ramp and so on. So here, what did we demonstrate? We demonstrated that you could get a high-level idea from a demonstration, practice a little bit on your own, learn things in a general enough form so that they can be combined later to solve totally new problems. So this is what we think gives us leverage. I'm going to do another example of this. This is, again, the fundamental idea is similar, but here it's a little bit different when we focused on the information gathering part in particular. So here now, imagine that the robot has learned a skill, right? It's done what Russ was talking about. Maybe it's a diffusion policy. It's good at pizza spreading, or it's good at pouring. So it's learned a really awesome motor skill. So that's important. It's good to learn motor skill. But then you have to figure out, how can you use that motor skill to do the stuff that you need? When should you pour? When should you spread pizza dough? What are the preconditions, right? You shouldn't spread pizza dough when there's no sauce, you know, all these things. Right? So what are the conditions under which a policy that I've learned will have a desired effect? If I can learn that, then I can take this whole thing as a package, put it in my general repertoire of skills, use a general purpose planner, and put it together to do a more complicated job. So we can get a bunch of examples of doing something. In this case, think about pouring, right? We can describe the situation of pouring in terms of what we're pouring out of, what we're pouring into, the relative pose of the two things, maybe the viscosity of the stuff. I don't know, all kinds of things like that. And what we want to predict is, if we were to call our pouring skill in this situation, how much of the stuff would end up where we want it to go, right? So in some good arrangements, it'll work great. In some bad arrangements, it will work not very well. We use some machine learning method called Gaussian process regression. I'll say something about that. The reason that we're careful about how we do the machine learning stuff in this case is that data on a robot, especially on a real robot, is very expensive. So here I show you examples of the robot gathering information. Right? So it's doing experiments. And it's actually deciding, it's telling us, oh, I want to pour from a small thing into a big thing now, or a big thing into a small thing. And it's practicing scooping and pouring. It's planning its own experiments. We are picking chickpeas up off the floor. It turns out, just before the pandemic struck was when we were doing this, and we left chickpeas in the lab. And when we came back, the mice had a really awesome chickpea dinner. But anyway, okay, so here we go. So data is expensive, we pick up chickpeas, but the robot learns how to do things. And having learned these things, now it can combine what it learned with what it already knew. So now I'll just end by showing you the robot doing some stuff and kind of narrating it. We put objects on the table, the objects could have been in any arrangement, and we give it goals in something like language, in logic actually. We say, oh, there should be stuff in the bowl, and the bowl should be on top of the tray, or whatever. And it just plans, right? So it just figures out, oh, I had to move the green box out of the way so that I could pick the thing up that I needed to pour. There's actually no additional learning here. This is mostly reasoning. In a minute, I'll show you, okay, so here we told it to put some stuff in the bowl and serve it. I'll show you one more example, and then I'll be out. And so in this next case, you'll see that the bowl is over on one side and it couldn't reach to pour over there. So it figures out, just by reasoning about spatial arrangements, that it should push the bowl into the space in front of it and then pour into it. And so this is putting together things it already understands. So we think we can get human-like generalization ability by learning world models that are combinatorially and efficiently reusable. We get the combinatorial reusability by building something in, as engineers, into our system that scaffolds both offline and online learning, and we'll get efficient reasoning by having sparse and kind of focused causal models. Thank you.